All right, welcome, welcome, welcome to Christ Clarity Satsang, where you actually have the opportunity to participate through open ears with a talk that is aligned with sanity. Where else do you go in the world if you really want to hear sanity? I suppose Muji is one option. I've never attended a satsang. I'm not privy to, you know, anything other than the YouTube videos, but he certainly speaks as one from the standpoint of sanity. And what we're doing here is also speaking from the standpoint of sanity, slightly different emphasis, as to be expected. But it's a wonderful thing to be able to hear speech from the standpoint of sanity, because the world shuts it out. The world of the personality shuts it out. Personality is incapable of speaking from the standpoint of sanity. Personality is just a tool of the ego. That's all that it is. And the ego is just a tool of the mind. So it's a tool using a tool. And the mind is just a tool of spirit. So it's a tool using a tool using a tool. Spirit is the one that chooses ideas. Mind is the one that presents ideas to spirit. Mind is not a free agent. It cannot disagree with an idea that spirit gives it. It cannot say, "Spirit, I don't want to use that idea. Choose another." No. It as a servant, it simply presents the idea that spirit chooses for it. And in the case that we're dealing with right now, spirit presented the idea to mind of wanting to be prime creator. Spirit wanted to be prime creator. And so mind had to present a way to make this seem possible. And that's what existence is all about. It makes it seem possible, makes it seem plausible, even though it's impossible, not plausible. It's not reasonable, it's not actual. And that is why the voice of reason is what we use, is the tool to see through the ego's presentation, the mind's presentation, egoic mind. The ego is just the tool that mind is using to give the presentation. It's like, so spirit chooses the idea, mind is presenting the idea. The sum total of all the trickery that mind is using, we call the ego. It seems to give us guidance. And then the personality is a tool that the ego is using that is very useful to deceive spirit and to make spirit forget what it is. Because what mind has to do is it has to make spirit believe that spirit is no longer spirit, that it is something else, that it has somehow been able to separate from what it is. And the reason why mind has to do this is because what spirit is, it is the prime created. It's an extension of the mind of God. God, the prime creator, extends itself as a play of ideas, and spirit is the activity of playing with those ideas. But God, the prime creator, is the one behind it all. It is the prime creator. So spirit, if it wants to believe it's plausible that it can be prime creator, has to forget God the prime creator, has to believe God the prime creator has been destroyed, has been damaged, or needs to be replaced, has to believe it's possible to replace God the prime creator, has to believe it's possible to create a new reality. All these things. So mind has this juggling act of all these sort of different themes that have to be accounted for. And that is why we say that the egoic mind is conflicted, because it doesn't have just one purpose. It has numerous purposes, and it has to account for all of these purposes, and they conflict with one another. Existence is very inherently conflicted. The ego's fighting with itself, really. When you see conflict, when you see fights, that's the ego fighting with itself. Crazy, isn't it? It's like a mad person beating themselves up, pounding themselves. Ah, you know, you'd say they're crazy, right? Well, the ego is insane, and therefore the personality is insane, and therefore everything on the level of personality is simply insanity, which is why you have such little opportunity to listen to sanity in this world, because everything from the level of the personality is insanity. Because whatever it says is going to be conflicted with something else that it'll say also. And those two things will fight, and there'll be conflict. The ego can't agree on anything because it's only plausibility. The ego's trying to find a way. It can't really find a way, but it's trying to find a way. So it says, maybe this, maybe that. You need to forget completely what you are, but you're attracted. The ego knows you're attracted to what you are, to remembering. So the ego has to somehow appease this attraction, at the same time shift it off the tracks so it doesn't really return to remembrance. It's kind of like the ego will put you on the tracks, and you think you're going towards remembrance, and then as you're going down the tracks, the ego will shunt you off, gradually shunt you off the tracks like that, and before you know it, you're going in a different direction. Gradually it will do it like that. So the experience in existence is that the spiritual path keeps being futile for most of us, because the ego is really sponsoring it in order that it can make us believe that we're going in the right direction, and then it gives us false guidance, and before you know it, we're off track again. That's why it's very rare to hear just pure, sane talk about the entire situation here. Why it's so valuable to practice with open ears. Open ears is the key. It's not a question of agreeing or disagreeing. You're simply listening to find something that's helpful. Okay, it's a different way of listening. The personality listens to agree or disagree, to align or unalign or whatever, judgmental listening. Open ears is a listening, simply saying, what can I get out of this? What nuggets of wisdom that'll help me decrease my delay towards remembrance? What can I get out of this? That's listening with open ears. It's the essential skill set that all of us require. So as you listen to this video, the satsang here, with open ears, get out of it what you can. And don't worry about the rest, because there'll be more. And there's always more on the path. You keep getting more and more and more and more and more and more momentum as you continue to acquire more. It's mathematics. You start out very simple, 1 + 1 = 2, and as you build up in mathematics, you're able to use symbols. Like eventually you get to the point with advanced physics, like E = mc². There's very simple symbols that relate to the entirety, you know, the entirety of everything. E = mc², very simple formula, isn't it? But it relates to the totality of the speed of light, etc. And then from that you can derive other equations, but it's you need to build up bit by bit some understanding, some clarity. And the more you hear it, it percolates like a percolation pond. You pour the water in the percolation pond and it percolates down, 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 down. Before you know it, you've got groundwater. You turn on the tap and there's a flow of really clean, pure tap water. But first you have to put the water in the percolation pond and let its gravity do its work. Same thing on satsang. You listen seriously, you listen with open ears, and you take more and more and more in. And you may not realize it. The personality doesn't realize the progress. Doesn't really know what's going on exactly. But the progress is being made. The ego is in charge of existence. And the ego, again, is just a term relating to actually all the different trickeration that the mind is using. And the principle of guidance within existence that the mind is providing to keep us in state of deep forgetfulness, we call that the ego. Because there is guidance in existence. It's just wrong guidance. It's not that the ego doesn't give us guidance, it does. It can offer us very seemingly amazing guidance, miraculous guidance, but it's only for the purpose of misleading us eventually. It's very important to hear this, that the ego has to account for our attraction back towards remembrance. We have a tremendous attraction to truth and remembrance. And if the ego didn't step in and usurp that somehow, co-opt it, and use it for misdirection, we would wake up very soon. We would remember, we would choose remembrance very soon. And yet the ego does do that. The ego sends in all sorts of gurus and teachers and teachings and etc. that get interpreted at the personality level. And from there, it eventually disintegrates into just a personality situation. It's constantly happening here in this world. And in order to get free from that, you need to develop tremendous clarity, listen to the voice of sanity, wherever you can find it. That gives you an overview of the whole situation here. And practice from the standpoint of this overview, the big picture. The big picture. It's all important. Don't get lost in the details. The ego will trip you up by getting you involved in all sorts of semantics and details, etc. Don't do that. Forget about the details, because ultimately it's very simple. Very, very simple. And that is, the remedy is to overlay the entire situation. It's not to solve the ego's problems at all. The ego's problems are unsolvable. It's simply overlay the entire situation. Accept the overlay. The effect of the idea of not trying to be prime creator is an overlay of everything the ego has done and is doing and will ever do. And it just sits there peacefully, quietly, not doing anything. The overlay is not doing anything. It's just there. It's just present. It just is. It's not attacking. It's not judging. It's not solving any problem. It's not doing anything. But that provides the remembrance for us of what we really are, which is spirit. The ego tries to pull us into solving problems at the level of the personality, the person, level of problems of existence, tries to pull us into that, saying that if we're really benevolent and compassionate and wise, etc., that we would be able to solve the problems. But I tell you, there is no solution to the ego's problems. The ego is inherently conflicted and is going in many, many different directions all at once, and all of them are vitally necessary in order to keep the delusion strong, the illusion, the mirage of existence, in order to keep it viable as a means of forgetfulness for us. All of those competing factions have to continuously be in play. You cannot get rid of one of those factions and still maintain deep forgetfulness. Remember, the ego's goal, purpose, is to maintain deep forgetfulness for us. That's what it does. It's its only purpose, so that everything that it does is towards that objective. The ego was born of a lie, and the lie is that we can separate from reality and be prime creator. That's a lie. It's a whim. It's a whim that can never be realized. So the belief system based on this false premise is a false belief system and can never be true, can never be made true. And yet this belief system doesn't know that it's a false belief system. It's unaware of that. That which is born of a lie is not aware of truth. So the ego simply references its own belief system, as if it's based on truth. Therefore, self-referencing will guide towards truth. Not true. It's based on a lie. So all self-referencing that the ego does simply continues to reinforce the lie. That's why you cannot find clarification by listening to the ego, by listening on the level of the personality. Is impossible. You simply will go on a wild goose chase, and you will get involved in all sorts of struggles and personality things and details that you shouldn't be involved in. Now, the ego has a awareness of sorts that there is some remedy, and it's terrified of this remedy because the ego is built, arises from the desire to be prime creator and the belief that spirit must become prime creator, otherwise spirit will be destroyed. That's the lie that the ego is built on. That's what it arose from, the notion that somehow we must become prime creator because the prime creator has been damaged or harmed or destroyed, etc. So the ego is terrified of anything that seems to bring spirit back towards remembrance of what it is, thinking that it's bringing back remembrance of spirit's destruction, because spirit is part of the prime creator. So the ego feels this as threat, as a severe threat, and tries to stop it. So the true remedy is, again, the overlay, which that the idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to one effect which overlays all other effects. It's called the overlay, the peace beyond understanding, the pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure stillness, pure emptiness, the great space, all referring to the same effect. This effect is not modifiable. It just is. It's not doing anything, just is. Now the ego senses this vaguely and feels it's a complete threat, but it knows that we're attracted to it. So what the ego does is it tells the personality the personality is supposed to work on overlaying existence with something, with what? With beauty, with culture, with civilization. The ego will tell us that we need our mission, our destiny, our purpose. The ego will say, God created you for this purpose, and then it will tell you what the purpose is. And the purpose, the ego will tell you, is that you're supposed to overlay existence, all of existence, with some divine order, divine beauty, that we're supposed to be gardeners of the cosmos, bringing beauty wherever we go, and eventually we'll overlay the entire cosmos with beauty. Now, why is the ego telling us that? Because it's a substitute for choosing the true overlay. See how that is? The ego aligns with the notion of overlay, but then displaces it onto something else. So, as we're trying to beautify the world, we think we're actually working on the overlay. And so we don't even check in to see if it's true or not. We feel very righteous about it. And the personality level, we're all subject to this. And my advice is, don't fight it. That's what I do. I don't fight it. I went along with this overlay. I still do. I'm still planting flowers, beautifying everything, and making everything just look, you know, so beautiful and nice. But I'm aware that's just the personality level. And instead of, you know, fighting and getting angry with it, I don't even say anything about it. I just continue the satsang and seeing that what we need to do is simply choose the overlay of everything. Don't try to change anything. We don't need to beautify anything, really. Do not need to at all. And yet, at the personality level, we believe that we do. So it's a very interesting dynamic. And my experience is to don't fight against the personality. Because there again, you're trying to change something about existence, which is not the way. Don't try and change anything the way, whatever it is, just let it be the way that it is. And realize that when you choose the overlay, this too will be overlaid perfectly. So it's very key to realize the ego will give you advice that seems as if you're working on the overlay. But the overlay is not something you work on, it's something you choose. Okay? So you, as you beautify the world, as you build beautiful buildings and plant beautiful parks and set up beautiful resorts and create beautiful artwork and music and literature, and as you create all sorts of group endeavors and beautiful experiences here in this world, that's all the guidance of the ego, 100%. The voice of reason, Holy Spirit, does not guide in that way. The voice of reason will simply tell you, look, you don't have to solve any of the ego's problems at all. You don't have to make the ego happy. Because the purpose of the overlay is simply to remember what we are, just as the purpose of existence is to forget what we are. That's it. It's that simple. So whatever the overlay gives us, the remembrance of what we are, and the personality gives us forgetfulness of what we are. So you either choose one or the other as primary, and the other becomes like a shadow to you. As long as you're choosing the personality as primary, the overlay will be like a faint shadow. You're not really aware of it. And if you choose the overlay, then the personality will be like a faint shadow, not really aware of it. Yet the personality can still be functioning in the world, but it's not important. You can still plant flowers. But you probably won't be as motivated to do so because you realize the folly of it. The ego literally, following the ego's guidance means that you will have to be completely dedicated to beautifying and perfecting existence endlessly. Not only do you have to plant all the flowers, you have to maintain all of them, you have to water them, you have to fertilize them, you have to clean them up all the time, take off the dead heads, you have to protect them from the gophers and the moles and the grubs and from the heat and the cold and the wind and from funguses and insects and every manner of vulnerability, and you have to change them as they get old. You have to trim them and clean up their droppings and the leaves and etc. And you have to protect them from the deer and the animals that will come and cause problems. You have to protect them from fire, from everything. And you have to expand that continuously. So the scope of your work just becomes exponentially great. And of course the body gets tired and gets worn out. Then you have to drop the body and get a new body and continue on indefinitely. That's the ego's plan. It's a horrible plan. Indefinite indentured servitude to the ego's insane plan of sort of patina of perfection over all of existence. Why? So that we'll accept that instead of choosing a new idea. That's all. That's why. Because the ego knows if we choose a new idea, we'll remember what we are. That's it. So the ego at all costs is working to prevent us simply from choosing a new idea and from experiencing the effect of that idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, because the ego knows it's curtains for it if it does that. And the ego knows we want to choose a new idea, it knows we want to experience the overlay, so the ego says, hey, you can experience the overlay and I'll guide you as to how to do that. And so now here you go, here's a way to do it. Start cleaning up, start beautifying, start making things better, start enriching culture, start being a better person, start working all the stuff, working on the level of personality, make yourself better grooming, more beautiful, more attractive, make everything more attractive, make existence more attractive so you're attracted to it. That's the ego's plan. And if you really, really, really want to experience the overlay, which I did and do, then when the ego gives you this guidance, you are willing to be a super worker. You're willing to work 24 hours a day, nonstop, and nothing seems to be too much. You'll tackle any difficulty, and the ego, loves that, and will work you to death, literally. Because it takes whatever willingness you have to work on this, it takes it and pushes, gotta do it. The ego doesn't even care if you sleep or not. It'll drive you right into the grave. Because it, at all costs, it's trying to get you to work on that instead of choosing a new idea and effortlessly experiencing the effect of that idea. So you see, there's a very clear demarcation between the ego's guidance and the guidance of the voice of reason, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God. The voice of reason will just very simply and clearly tell you that you don't need to solve any of the problems of existence. You don't need to do anything about it, because all those problems are there simply for the purpose of getting us to forget what we are. That's the sole purpose and reason of any of it. So what is it that needs to be fixed? Why does working on that help? Because as soon as you work on all that, you're working at the level of the personality. And you'll inevitably be drawn into conflict with other facets that are working in the opposite direction. You see, in existence, there is work to have superficial remembrance of what we are. Like I said, work on a superficial overlay of beauty of existence. And then there's also, at the same time, desperate action to deepen the forgetfulness of what we are. Okay, and then those two come in conflict, you see? So no matter what you do in existence, you're going to be upsetting some other facet of the ego. And the ego cannot coordinate all this, because it needs both sides to be working. And when one comes in conflict, the ego just throws up its hands and you know, just shrugs its shoulders and doesn't have any answer for you. When the ego's guidance doesn't work, what does it do? Throws up its hands, shrugs its shoulders, and says, well, just keep working, do the next thing. Doesn't have any answers. And so we're left to continue to think about and consider the voice of reason, the voice of sanity, that simply informs us of the very easy way out of this whole incredible mess. At the level of the personality, it is an absolute impossibility. And when you try to solve the situation at the level of personality, your mind will be completely overburdened. Your body will be overburdened. Your emotions, everything. You'll feel like you have the weight of the world on your shoulders. And you do. You do, because you're trying to take every viewpoint into consideration and then somehow find a viewpoint that satisfies all those viewpoints. Okay? There is no such viewpoint. The overlay is not a viewpoint. It's an effect of another idea. That's it. It simply relates to the idea that gave rise to it. That is, non-negation. No attempt to negate. No attempt to modify. No attempt to change. No attempt to get rid of the prime creator. No attempt to get rid of anything. Not trying to change reality. So that the effect is stable. It's not modifying itself. That is not some sort of viewpoint that satisfies all the personality viewpoints. No, it doesn't satisfy any of them. Not really. It's not trying to. It simply is. And it knows that it doesn't need to solve any of the personality problems in order to be the perfect reminder of what reality is. So it doesn't matter whether problems are solved or not. Perhaps all sorts of miracles can take place at the personality level. It doesn't matter to the overlay. It doesn't matter one way or the other. If their miracles take place or they don't take place, it's all the same. Sometimes those who have accepted the overlay and are abiding in the overlay. Sometimes people come to them, personalities come to them with sicknesses and illnesses and problems, and those sicknesses are healed. You know, they vanish, the problems are solved, etc., etc. But the overlay is not trying to do any of that. And it doesn't matter one way or the other. Whether it's solved or not solved makes no difference to the overlay. The overlay still overlays whatever occurs in existence exactly the same. Whether something happened or didn't happen, whether someone is sick or well, the overlay overlays all situations, all conditions equally. Just is. It is what it is. In all circumstances, it simply is what it is. It's not being modified or changed in any way. So what good is spending time changing things, modifying things, trying to make things more beautiful? Whether things are beautiful or not doesn't matter to the overlay. It matters to the personality, yes, because the personality feels like it's making progress towards freedom from misery. Of course, the personality believes that everything it's doing will result eventually in peace of mind, but it's not true, because it's the ego that's giving this guidance, and of course, the cosmos cannot be overlaid with perfectly overlaid with something that is completely stable and non-modifiable from the level of the personality. Because how can we account for our continued attraction towards remembering what we are? That'll never go away. So how can we make an overlay that'll make that disappear? Cannot do it. We will simply struggle and fight over different ways and means to try and accomplish this, different ways and means to try and create a new reality. Everything is turmoil in existence. It's all necessary for the forgetfulness to be there, for us to be induced, continue to remain in the stupor of forgetfulness. All of that is necessary. And so, but we don't need to attack it. We don't need to change a thing. There's nothing wrong with working at the personality level to make your house clean, so to speak. But that's not the answer. It might make it easier to spend some time focusing on the answer. That's possible. One has to always put focus on the truth first in one's life. And then whatever the personality wants to do, the personality will always claim that it's making things better. Well, maybe yes, maybe no. But so the key is to always have the priority on your time. First claimant to your time is satsang. That's the first claimant. Number one. And number two and number three also. And then whatever the personality wants to do, you can go along and keep up appearances. It's usually important in cultures to keep up appearances. If you drop out completely, you know, people would just, you know, just sometimes it doesn't work. Depending where you are, some places you can drop out, and like in a big city, maybe nobody will even pay attention to you or care about it one way or the other. But in an affluent, you know, suburban place of great safety and all of this, you cannot just drop out like that. You have to keep up appearances. So depending on where you're at, you have to do whatever at the personality level, whatever is minimally necessary. That's fine, but you have to place the emphasis of your effort on the level of sanity and truth, which means you're not trying to solve the problems of the world. Some people are born into families where they're obliged to solve the problems of the world, that they're supposed to be working on that. And so they may simply go along with that at the level of personality. But inwardly, they're finding time to really study truth, actually. And they're not really committed to solving the problems. They're going through the motions. But they're wiser. They realize this isn't it. This is not going to solve, give me peace of mind. It's all a charade. It's all a misguidance by the ego. but they continue to go through the motions. And they may even appear to be more gung-ho than others, because they're fighting against revealing to the world that they're really not interested in this, and so they're overcompensating. So it's hard to judge people in this world, really it is. You never know what's going on underneath, whether they're overcompensating or not. It's like we have a saying, that when you're the middle class, you're losing your money, you're losing your position, you're slipping into poverty, what you do is you start dressing very nicely. You dress better and better and better. The poorer you get, the better you dress, to try to overcompensate, you know, and make it appear like you're going in the opposite direction. Everything's going great. And then those who do have affluence and are doing well, they generally dress very casually. They're not even concerned about how they look at all. And it's the same thing on the spiritual path. Maybe those who are really profoundly into it, into truth, on the surface they may appear to be very superficial, so that they're at this, they want to maintain a facade of the personality in the world so that nobody suspects that they're really closing in on truth. And that's what I've done. I've just maintained a facade of the personality, being very much superficial and into the personality, so that nobody seems to suspect that I'm closing in on the truth. Makes it easier. Nobody bothers you. So you can do that too. There's different styles. You don't need to grow your hair long and be a hippie and a dropout and all of that counterculture figure. Don't need to be a wild person. You can just appear to be very normal and superficial, adapted to the personality level. But it's just a thin facade. You're just keeping up appearances. But what you're really involved with is seeing the big picture, the total big picture, the real picture, which is very simple. The details don't really matter. And the details of how you're going to save the world don't really matter. You might say some blah, 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 blah. And people say, oh, yeah, they're really, really smart. He's got some plan to save the world. But you know the world cannot be saved. It cannot even really be helped. But you can be saved from the world. You can be saved from the dreams that you have dreamed, the nightmares that you have projected. You can definitely be saved from that. That's all that salvation is dealing with. Salvation is not talking about the world. The world is just a stage. Salvation is talking about the dreamer, the one who's doing the dreaming, having them wake up and realize that the dream that they were dreaming, they had no effect on reality whatsoever. I'm going to turn on this mosquito deterrent because the mosquitoes are coming in and they're getting me. I forgot to turn this on. So don't forget to turn your mosquito deterrent on in life, okay? In life, you need a mosquito deterrent. And sometimes keeping up a facade of normality is the best mosquito deterrent of all. Because if you seem to know what you're talking about, the personality will come and pester you because they think that you have some advice as to how they can be better serve the ego's plan, better provide this overlay for the world. You know, set up gardens everywhere. My gosh, I was involved in so much. How to beautify the world. Setting up beautiful sanctuaries all over the planet. Incredible, you know, gardens of beauty and peacefulness, etc. And that's all very well and good, but it has nothing to do with salvation. So normalcy can be the ultimate deterrent, facade of normalcy. No reason to be a weirdo. I mean, the personality will think that if you're not doing something to save the planet, that somehow you are irrelevant. Or if you don't at least appear to be supportive of that, that somehow you're ignorant. Because they, you see, the personality believes that following the guidance of the ego makes the personality smart and relevant. And so those who are following the vice of the ego, they feel that they're smart, very smart, intelligent, doing the right thing. And those who are not following the advice of the ego and the guidance, they are viewed as being ignorant and in need of, quote-unquote, education. They need to be educated. The advice of the ego is what we call our intelligence. We think it's our intelligence. It's just the guidance of the ego. And the counterpart to that is the guidance of the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason. And when you listen to that, then you realize what real intelligence is. Very different than the so-called intelligence of the ego, which is nothing but self-referencing plausibility, overlooking what is actual entirely. One doesn't have to make announcements to the world that one is on the spiritual path, etc. That's usually nothing but trouble. Leads to personality cults. In everyday life, I'm just a normal guy, just yak, you know, yakking it up, yucking it up with whoever, and just being, you know, Joe normal. At the personality level, that's fine. There's no need to do anything different than that. Doesn't matter what your position is in at the personality level, doesn't matter. You have equal access to truth at all times. Equal access to clarity at all times. You can be a shoe shiner and just do that, and then spend your free time contemplating truth, listening to the voice of reason. And you can choose the overlay just as much as anybody else can choose it. Or you can be a billionaire playing that game and pretending to be, you know, all engrossed in that game, and yet really beneath the surface, when you have the time, you make sure you have the time to be consider truth, consider clarity, voice of reason, and see through everything and realize you don't have to solve, nothing has to be solved. It only needs to be overlaid. Again, nothing has to be solved or resolved. Simply choose the overlay. The overlay will overlay whatever it is. Whatever arises, the overlay already overlays that perfectly. And that's the remedy. That's the remembrance of what one is. Not any change in the condition that the overlay brings. Now, that's not it, right? Let's say you have the overlay present and people get healed from it. Now, that's not the point. Doesn't see the overlay. That doesn't remind spirit of what spirit is. Anybody, any change taking place. Change doesn't remind spirit of what it is. No change reminds spirit of what it is. Non-modification. Because what spirit is doesn't change. What the prime creator is doesn't change. The isness of reality doesn't change, cannot be changed. Everything that is manifest in reality always maintains itself exactly as it is. Life cannot harm life. Life cannot change life. Life cannot diminish life. Life cannot attack life, corrupt life, distort life. Cannot do any of that. Whatever is manifested continues to be manifested exactly as it is. And reality works by expanding and choosing ideas and experiencing those ideas. Ideas are like seeds. You water the seed, the plant grows, and it's beautiful like that, and then the plant remains in that beautiful way. And if you want to choose this idea again, you can choose the idea again, and again the plant blooms and stays. But the plant doesn't wither and die. It's not like that. It remains as it is. Now the question is, will existence remain as it is, as an effect of an idea? That's possible. It's also possible that it remains simply in the state of a blessing, that it becomes ultimately transformed into simply a blessing. That within that blessing is contained the real totality of that idea. That the idea is simply blessed, is simply overlaid. And that all of these effects, they're not true manifestation. Their imagination and dreams. So I said, in reality, all manifestation remains as it is, but existence is per se is not a manifestation. You might call it a non-manifestation. And the true condition of a non-manifestation is simply to choose to overlay it. So the overlay would remain as the manifestation of the idea of trying to be prime creator. That's what would remain of it. But other ideas that are not trying to separate from reality, what they manifest remains. But it doesn't preclude us from choosing that idea again and watching the whole thing unfold again. And mind, being so creative, can produce spontaneous expressions of ideas that can have variations and yet still perfectly express the idea chosen. For example, we might want to have an idea of watching a perfect sunset over a beautiful ocean with beautiful waves breaking and everything is so serene, and that idea will give rise to the expression, the manifestation of that, and we can experience it. And then let's say we choose a different idea. Well, that perfect sunset and ocean and waves, etc., still is manifested to be experienced whenever we want to. But when we choose another idea, the effects of that idea are also manifested. And if we go back and choose the idea of a sunset and waves, etc., choose the idea again, see what mind presents again. Mind will present another manifestation from that, not getting rid of the first one, but simply another one that could be a beautiful variation on it. And so the first one and the second one will still both be manifested eternally, as well as the other idea we talked about. Everything that we choose, all ideas, all manifestation is eternal. And it just, the richness of reality keeps expanding and expanding and expanding and expanding like that. No end to it. Only this idea of trying to be prime creator is a dead end. Because really what is here is nothing. It's zero. It's all flat. So existence, reality cannot manifest nothing. So what reality, this idea, really manifests is a blessing, is an overlay. And so that overlay will always be there. Always be there. And if we want to look at what this idea of wanting to be prime creator manifested, the blessing, the overlay, will always be there in reality for us. And these are high teachings, ultimate type of teachings. Gets into a scope beyond what is normally gotten into. These are questions that actually spirit has, not personality. Personality is not interested in these type of clarifications. Personality is interested in getting enlightened. Okay. Personality pursues enlightenment. But spirit not knows that that's unimportant. But what is important is spirit remembering what spirit is. And the concerns that spirit has about that relate to things like what we just clarified, or what will happen to existence once we choose a new idea. Well, again, the overlay will always be there, the blessing. It will remain as a blessing upon all other ideas, like that, always there. If we want to return back to it, it'll be there. But it's very unlikely that we will choose the idea of trying to be prime creator, choose that idea again. Because we will have the complete wisdom and understanding that the overlay is simply what actually arises from that choosing of that idea, which is to automatically choose another idea. It's the one idea that the manifestation of this idea is to actually choose another idea. That is the manifestation of it. Because the idea of trying to be prime creator literally goes nowhere. Has no manifestation from it. How can it have an actual manifestation of spirit saying that it's prime creator? How can it be actual? It cannot. There cannot be any actual manifestation from that. But there can be a choice of a new idea, which is the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which an idea which would only be chosen as a remedy for the first idea, right? Spirit would not, in its play with ideas, say, I'm going to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That's an absurdity, because the spirit is already functioning as not prime creator. So the only way that idea would be chosen is as a remedy for the idea of trying to be prime creator. Again, these are concerns that spirit has as it orients towards remembering what it is. Personality is not interested in this stuff. Personality is desperate to be enlightened because it believes that by being enlightened, it won't have to choose a new idea. That's the truth. Most people who go to teachers go to them from the level of the personality. And they're looking to get enlightened. The personality is looking to get enlightened. So that a new idea won't have to be chosen because the personality is afraid of that. The ego is afraid of that. The ego feels threatened by it. The ego feels its purpose is threatened. The ego feels that identity is threatened. The ego feels the prime creator is threatened by that, because it believes the spirit has to become the new prime creator. And then the ego believes it has an absolute mandate for this. So, most of us go to gurus, teachers, etc., from the level of the personality. Of course, it's the level of the spiritualized personality, quote-unquote spiritualized, meaning that the personality is seeking some spiritual qualities or experience, some change in the personality, that some positive change that can empower the personality in some way, make the personality happy, etc. The goal of that, of course, is to keep the personality viable and keep the game going. So, most of the teachings seem to be relate back to enlightening the personality. And spirit is not interested in that. It's really not. Spirit is not really interested in enlightenment. It's interested in experiencing the overlay, experiencing nirvana. Abiding in the self. That's what spirit's interested in. And how that relates to, again, getting back to functioning fully, you know, the way it was created to function. And what will happen to existence once spirit does that. Those kind of questions. That's what spirit's interested in. Spirit wants to get back, one, to perfect remembrance of what it is, and two, to function fully the way it was created, because that's the will of God. The will of God is that spirit functions fully the way it was created to function, not partially or in a tiny bit or in, to be idle or paralyzed. No, fully functional the way it was created to function. And that's what spirit wants to do. So spirit is very keen on clarifying those areas of concern related to that. Doesn't care about the personality, whether the personality is enlightened or not. Doesn't matter at all, one bit. Because the overlay will overlay everything. Will overlay a person, an unenlightened personality, will overlay a quote-unquote enlightened personality. It makes no difference. There are some personalities that believe that they're enlightened. And they, what they do is they spend all their time trying to convince others' personalities that they are enlightened, that they're an enlightened personality. And eventually it gets into coercion and all sorts of troubles. And the personality, the so-called enlightened personality, will inevitably push others towards improving the world. You know, building hospitals and charitable works and all these kinds of things. That's the so-called enlightened personality. But that doesn't remind spirit of what spirit is at all. It has nothing to do with it. So it only really serves the purpose of maintaining forgetfulness of what spirit is. These are truths. This is saint talk here from the level of spirit. And of course, in hearing this, the personality is going to say, ah, this is crazy or whatever. But spirit will say, yes, this is very, very true. Very glad to hear this, because I can feel right orientation here. Spirit has a feeling. It's not a personality feeling. It's a feeling of right orientation. And spirit says, yeah. Let's hear more of this. Let's hear more of this. And the personality is not really that interested. The personality wants to hear something different. It does. Wants to be entertained. Wants to be told that it can reach enlightenment. Wants to be given exercises that it can develop. It can develop spiritual power, spiritual abilities. And the personality will always come up short, but it's always thinking that, you know, it's almost there and it just needs to do something so that it is enlightened, or it needs to beautify a little more so that it's carried out its beautification mandate. Needs to work on overlaying the world a little more, providing, look at the world, the activity of everyone. What are we doing right now in the world? We're trying to overlay the world with technology. That's 100% working on the ego's overlay plan of overlay. We're trying to set up a one world government, new world order, one world government. Again, that's the ego's plan of setting up the overlay here on this planet. We're trying to connect everybody, wirelessly connected at all times. That's the ego's plan of the overlay. We're trying to set up social networks, everybody in the world connected in through social networks. That's the ego's plan of the overlay. We're trying to educate everybody. That's the ego's plan of overlay. There have been those in history who chose the overlay, the true overlay. Chose not to try and be prime creator. They didn't know how to read or write. They had no education. Made no difference whatsoever. Truth is not something that requires education. It requires clarity. Oftentimes people spend their whole entire lives being educated and not 1 minute of their lives gaining clarity. They're only gaining education and learning. That's the ego. That's the personality. How are we doing here? Almost an hour. Get a drink. make a little adjustment here. All right. The personality cannot remember what spirit is. You know, what we're trying to do to level personality is to remember. Cannot. It's not the personality that's remembering what it is. It's spirit remembering what spirit is. Personality cannot remember what spirit is. Personality cannot overlay reality with existence. Existence is really an attempt to overlay reality. But instead we choose to overlay existence. Time cannot overlay eternity. Modification cannot overlay non-modification. These are simple facts. So the personality and everything that it's trying to do, let it do what it's trying to do. Don't try and interfere. Don't try to stop it. Because why interfere in futility? No matter what one does, it's still futile. It's better to place one's attention on choosing the overlay. The personality cannot experience the overlay. Cannot. The personality, you see, the personality is trying to have the great experience of the overlay, believing that finally, if it does, it will have succeeded in overlaying reality, which means that the personality is now the prime creator. So the personality is trying to have this experience that it can never have. Spirit can have this experience. Only spirit can have it. And when spirit has this experience, sometimes it drops the experience. It says, okay, I know the experience is here, real close. Now, if I drop it, set it down, the personality can pick it up. And what happens is the personality cannot pick it up. It fumbles it away. Doesn't know what it is. It says, whoa, that's terrible. I've got to change that. I don't want that. I need a variation on that one. So, spirit can choose a new idea, can experience the overlay, definitely. Easy for spirit. But spirit sets it down quickly so the personality can pick it up. That's a bad habit that spirit has. It's thinking that now spirit needs to remember what spirit is. I mean, that personality needs to remember what spirit is. So here's the opportunity for personality to do that. Yeah, that's really one of the great keys. You can remember truth. You can know truth. You can experience the overlay. Spirit can remember what it is. And then it will set it down so quickly and say, okay, as if it's being generous, you see, as if it's being paternal to the personality. As if it's saying, personality, here's your great opportunity. Look how benevolent I am. Look how loving and kind and gracious. I'm setting it right in your hands, the answer, the overlay. Just experience it, and you'll experience the bliss that I'm experiencing. Well, the personality will turn to the ego and say, what is this for? And then the ego will say, you know, wow, you know, it's a motivational tactic for you to get working beautifying the world and saving the world. So get to work now. You know, you have the motivation. Get to work. Set this aside over here, and you can return to it at some point in time. All sorts of ways the ego will misinterpret it, will tell the personality what to do with it, and personality doesn't know what to do, don't do with it. So don't set it down. Don't set the experience down. When the experience comes, when you choose the overlay, don't set it down. For the personality, it's a waste. The personality has no idea what to do with it. That's like setting a diamond down for a cat. The cat looks at it. What the cat does it do? The cat, you know, bats it and plays with it and knocks it around for a little while, tries to chew on it, and then walks away. It says, it's done. It's no fun. It's no fun. Personality does not understand the relevance of the overlay at all. It cannot. It thinks it can. Of course, the ego thinks its intellect can understand everything. So it'll never admit that it cannot understand what it is. It will try to understand what it is, but it does not understand. Because it cannot allow remembrance of what spirit is. Because any remembrance of what spirit is nullifies the importance and purpose of the ego and the personality. That's like saying that darkness can contain light. Let's say you have a glass and you cover it up as dark, and then you open up your hands, or you put your hands like this and it's all dark. You open up your hands and then you're saying, oh, the darkness is now containing, holding the light, you know. No, that's not true. When spirit remembers what it is, spirit will know then it's not the personality. So how can the personality remember what spirit is? Spirit will know that it's not the personality. So it's not the personality remembering. Spirit will know that it is the one that's doing the remembering. So it's a ludicrous situation. The more you look at it, the more ludicrous it will be. And yet we spirit is trying to be all benevolent and thinking that, you say, oh, personality, it needs to remember what I am too. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. Personality needs to be overlaid. Remember, the only purpose, the personality is just a tool. It doesn't know anything. It just acts from guidance on the ego, which also doesn't know anything, which acts on the guidance of the mind, which is just a servant of the idea that spirit chose. And personality doesn't really know anything. Just acts on guidance of the ego. And the ego will say, well, yeah, that's good. That's really good that you had the experience, the overlay, but that's just a step. You need to take the next step now quickly. You know, let's not lose any momentum. Let's go on to the next thing. There is that tendency of the egoic personality that thinks it's enlightened to always say, yes, but quickly go on to the next higher step. Set the overlay down, go on to the next greater step. You know, you're greater than the overlay. And that co-opts it very quickly, doesn't it? No, there is no greater step than the overlay as far as existence is concerned. Once the overlay is experienced and abided in perfectly, then spirit will just naturally begin to function fully the way it was created to function. Direct experiencing. Direct. Beyond awareness. Pure awareness is not our identity. Okay, this is something that is rarely taught here. Pure consciousness is not our identity. We're beyond that. Pure consciousness is the reminder of what we are. Pure awareness is the reminder of what we are. It's not what we are. Just like the self is not what we are. Abiding in the self, that's abiding in the remembrance of what we are. It's like a perfect reflection. But it is not what we are actually. Reflection is not the same as what is being reflected. Even a perfect reflection is still not the same. Because the final step, so to speak, the total, the complete resolution is for simply for spirit to function the way it was created. Fully function. way as it was created, which is to directly experience immediate, perfect, unmediated, direct experiencing, direct manifesting. And it, once perfect remembrance is very deep, then just very naturally the full functioning will take place. And that'll be beyond even pure awareness. But we're not concerned about that at all. So technically speaking, you know, pure awareness or that perfect silence, perfect peace beyond understanding, all the overlay, that is the goal. That is our goal. That is the final step for us. From the standpoint, from our standpoint, that is the final step. So do not listen to those who always are saying, yeah, but there's a further step beyond that, and there's a further step beyond that. That is how they keep the personality addicted to them. Personality will feel that it's experienced enlightenment. Maybe the overlay, the spirit has experienced the overlay for a minute, for a brief instant, and then it goes to the teacher and says, wow, there's an incredible experience I had. The teacher will say, yes, 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 of course, but that is just a temporary thing, and beyond that, there's something greater. And then the personality will get totally addicted to that type of teacher and teaching. And always the teacher then points to something greater, something greater. So the overlay may keep occurring, and yet the ego keeps interpreting it as just a step up a staircase, you know, as a way to enlighten the personality. Personality has become ever more enlightened, ever more enlightened. This is the story that the ego tells, that the personality is going to become ever more enlightened. And so the overlay is an orphan here in this world. I tell you for sure, the overlay is an orphan. If you pick it up and you go around and tell others about it, they'll say, you know, we don't have anything to do with that. Or if they're spiritual persons, spiritualized personality, they will say, oh, yes, 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 I know about that. I experienced that. Yeah, okay, but I've gone beyond that. I've reached higher levels than that. There's other stages beyond that. There's a corporate spiritual ladder that I've been climbing, and I'm going up ever higher. That's all the ego. That's all the diversion. That's all the distraction. That's a tall tale. The overlay is the answer. There is no other answer. The reason why we don't realize that is because we do not abide in it. Ramana Maharshi said, abide in the self. I mean, abide in the experiencing of the overlay. That's the only remedy. Not to experience it and then set it down and ask the ego what it means. Because the ego will gauge your reaction. It'll either say, ah, that was a false, demonic, satanic, terrible, misleading experience you had. How dare you do that? And get back here and get back on the right path, you know. Or if it sees that you truly have some profound attraction to that, it will say, yes, 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 that was a glorious experience, but now you really need to go beyond it and go higher than that, and here's all these bells and whistles to do that. Sound familiar? I'm sure it does to some of you. Now the overlay is the one and only answer, because the setting down the idea of trying to be prime creator, picking up the idea of not trying to be prime creator, that idea has only one effect that arises from it. Only one effect, not many. Doesn't have a whole corporate hierarchy of effects. All sorts of subtle effects, greater effects. It doesn't have any of that. It has one effect. That's the overlay. The overlay is just that presence of perfect isness. It's not trying to be anything other than just this isness. There are no levels there. There are no modifications. None. That's the vision of oneness. Vision of oneness has no levels in it. There is no other step, higher step than that. As I said before, the final outcome of abiding in that is simply a natural spirit naturally functioning in its full capacity. But that is not, cannot be called a step. So for our purposes, for all purposes in existence, there's only one remedy, one step. That's it. There are no stages at all. All stages belong to the personality and the ego. The overlay always is exactly as it is from the very beginning. It's always been exactly the way it is right now, exactly the way it will always be. No modification from the very beginning. It's never been modified in any way. Never will be modified in any way. So how could there be stages and steps in it? There are none. There are none. No steps, no stages whatsoever. And the reason why we set it down is because we think we've got the key to other steps, personality steps, right? We think, aha, now I've got the energy, the motivation, the focus to take those other steps. We think it's a means to an end, except the overlay is really an end in itself. Simply abide in the overlay. That is the true advice of sanity. And we can listen to that. It's not a problem. In fact, we can have a good laugh, and someday we will. It's a great thing to see through the whole situation. Not being judgmental, just objective. Just say, okay, this is what happens. The personality turns to the ego and says, what do I do with this experience? And then the ego says, okay, yeah, I know exactly what to do with this experience. This is your ticket to greater and greater things. And then, of course, the personality says, wow, okay, well, I don't want to just dwell in this within this overlay. I mean, if this is just a passport to greater and greater things, I need to get on with those greater and greater things. And the ego very cleverly will say, yeah, this is just a means so that you can fully express yourself in existence, okay? Trying to usurp the final outcome of this. Okay, and the personality thinks, okay, this I should be able to fully function in full human potential. I should be able to express my full human potential using this, the overlay, this experience, the overlay as a touchstone for doing that. Very clever, right? Very clever, but that is completely false. Because only when spirit has a perfect remembrance of what it is and it has abided in that remembrance, so that there's absolutely no other motivation except to abide in that remembrance. Zero motivation to change the world. Okay? And this is absolutely possible. Sri Anandamayi Ma was in this world and had zero desire or motivation to change the world in any way. None. Nothing. Which means she was abiding in the overlay perfectly. Had complete abidance without any thought whatsoever of trying to modify anything or change anything. Once we have that, once that is the condition of spirit, perfect remembrance, without any desire to take any other stage or any other step or modify anything, naturally then spirit will know how to function fully. And how to choose ideas, and how to manifest, how experience directly, because it won't have any desire to change or modify the experiencing, the effects of the idea that it chooses, okay? But what happens is when we experience the overlay, we turn to the ego for advice. The ego will say, okay, you got it. Now you need to function fully in existence. But that's not choosing new ideas. That is not the functioning of spirit. Because existence is nothing but modification. And what is spirit, what does ego ask you to do? It asks you to go about modifying everything in existence. Heal the sick, you know. Educate everybody. Enlighten everyone. Change what's going on here. Express yourself fully, you know, humanly, with all these good works, etc. Now, that's obviously the ego distracting you from simply abiding in the experiencing of the overlay, which will bring about complete cessation of any desire to change anything. So look at what the ego asks you to do. If the ego says to drop the overlay and it has something better for you, what is the ego asking you to do? Is it asking you to simply abide in something greater than the overlay? It's not possible, because the overlay is perfect non-modification. There can be nothing greater than perfect non-modification as far as a perfect way to remember spirit. So the idea that one experiences the overlay and then goes on to some higher contemplation is false. There is no higher contemplation. There is no higher meditation. So that wipes out the ego's notion that you can choose something other than the overlay and just abide in that. Not true. Because anything else other than the overlay will not be perfect remembrance of what spirit is, and one will have desires will arise to modify, and one will begin to try and modify, even to modify the experiencing that they're having. It's futile. So the ego either do that, or the ego will say, okay, use this experience of the overlay to go about modifying in a positive way in the world. Work on overlaying the world with beauty, with harmony, with love, with all these nice qualities, etc. Go about doing that and teaching others to do that. That's false teaching. The only true teaching is to tell others to abide in this overlay. That is the true teaching. Because of that, one can say that Ramana Maharshi gave the true teaching here, gave a very true teaching. So did Christ. Jesus Christ said, I am the way, there's only one way. Okay, he was speaking from the standpoint of the overlay. Jesus was actually speaking from that standpoint, as if the overlay is saying, look, I am the way. This is the way. It's like a personification of the overlay, a symbol of the overlay, a confession, a witnessing of the overlay here, saying, I am the way, and there's only one way. Ramana said the same. Abide in the self. That's all you need to do. Simply abide in that experience of the overlay. That's it. That's the only remedy. One does not abide in the overlay and then say, well, this is great, but I'm going to shoot for something higher. I'm going to have an even higher experience than this. But it certainly won't be a higher experience of non-modification. How can you be higher than perfect non-modification? Is there something greater than 100% perfection? Flawless non-modification? No, there is not. How could there be anything like that? What would happen is a play of modification takes place where it seems to keep looping back towards non-modification. And then one will say that this play is somehow greater. Not true. Because the purpose of experiencing the overlay is to have perfect remembrance of what one is or what spirit is, not to simply play with some kind of bliss, you know, playing with the blissfulness, moving back and forth towards overlay and then away from it and over it and just playing with this blissfulness. That's not the purpose. Purpose is for spirit to remember what it is. Spirit does not oscillate between modification and non-modification. Spirit is that which cannot be modified ever. So the bliss is not something to be played with. But the peace, the silence, the stillness, the non-modification is not something to be played with. It's not a toy to be played with. The ego will tell you that too. So, well, go ahead and play with this toy. Why not? See what that gets you. Maybe it'll get you something better. You see, the ego, at all costs, the ego does not want you to simply abide in the overlay. That's curtains for the ego. It knows it. That's curtains. So it will tell you anything other than that. The great thing about Ramana Maharshi is he said only that. That's all he did. That's all he did. He just abided in that overlay. That's all that he did. That's the right way. He did not play games with the bliss. He simply abided in the overlay. He didn't try to modify it. Simply abided in it. Didn't make any attempts to make it something else. Simply abided in it. And that's what we all can do. That's what we all must do. There's no exceptions. Everybody must do that. Abide in the overlay. abide in that experiencing of the non-modification, the effect of non-modification, which is isness, present isness. And the reason why we call it eternal isness is because it never changes from that isness. It's always, the isness is always the isness. So you know that the isness you're experiencing right now is the same isness that will be experienced trillions of years from now, or that was experienced in the past, exactly the same. Hasn't changed in quality one bit. Therefore, it transcends time and process, doesn't it? One doesn't need time anymore to experience. One realizes time is not necessary. Time is not necessary to experience this isness exactly the quality, the full quality that it has. It's not necessary. We don't have to wait till tomorrow. It won't increase. We don't have to wait until we're old. We don't have to wait 10 more lifetimes. Because let's say we waited 10 more lifetimes and then experienced the isness. It would be exactly the same. We would realize at that point, my gosh, I could have experienced that 10 lifetimes ago. And it would have been exactly the same experience. But the ego tells us, of course, that it is going to change and get better. Of course the ego says that. What else can it say? It will say that, you know, 10 lifetimes from now, the isness will be 10 times more powerful. And then, of course, when you reach the 10th lifetime, it'll tell you that 100 lifetimes from now, it'll be 100 times more powerful. And when you reach the 100th lifetime, it will tell you that in 1,000 lifetimes, it'll be 1,000 times more powerful. And that's how you get dragged through existence, keel-hauled through existence, really. Pulled through the mud and the muck of existence. False promises. We have to stop those false promises right now. We have to get away from them, break the spell that they have on us. Realize the isness right now is exactly the same isness that will always overlay existence. Quality will never change. The more we emphasize this, the closer we get to it. And where will you find this emphasis in the world? Will you find it when you turn on the radio, when you turn on the television, when you go see a movie, when you go out clubbing, when you go out to a concert, when you go to a social event, when you go to a sporting event, when you go recreation, vacationing, working, playing, eating, sleeping? Do you get any of this? Focus. We need only to remind ourselves that the quality of isness that we can experience right this moment is exactly the same quality that will always overlay existence, never changing in the slightest regard. And that this is the final step. It's the one and only step to remembering what we are. Other steps are not steps to remember what we are. They're steps to forgetting what we are. There are infinite steps to that, but all of them go nowhere. Up and down, but they're still completely vulnerable to remembering, to choosing the overlay, to experiencing it. And we need to only remind ourselves the quality of the isness, the non-modification, letting everything just be exactly as it is, not trying to change anything, just present isness. It's exactly the same now as it's always been and always will be. And it's overlaying all of existence with exactly the same quality, unmodified, never getting more, never getting less. And that is available to us right now. That experiencing is available to us right now. That overlay is available to us right now. We need only to remind ourselves of this fact. And again, what is it that reminds us of this? When we go out in the world, we have zero reminder of this. Zero. And it's a scary thing because we go out in the world and we, all that we remember is that we forgot something very important. We have this feeling, I know that there's some very important key I need to know. And I know that I forgot it, but I can't remember what it is. That's the frustration of existence, is we lose focus. It's so hard to find anything to pull our focus back. So we're saying right here, right now, that the isness, the overlay, is just a silent isness, not doing anything. Completely silent isness. Completely unmoving isness. A presence that is completely still. This perfect stillness. This perfect, non-moving, non-modifying, non-changing stillness and isness. Not trying, not growing, not decreasing, just abiding, just present. That quality that is with us right now is the very same quality that will always be with us. That will always be present in existence, will always overlay existence exactly like this. No change. We can wait a trillion years, or we can experience it now. It makes no difference. It's not keeping track of time. The overlay is not keeping track of any time whatsoever. It already is what it is. It doesn't need time to become what it is. And this overlay is a reminder of what we are. It is a reflection of what we are. It is not actually what we are. It is a reflection. So, we need to simply abide in it. If we think it is what we really are, the overlay is what we are, the pure awareness is what we are, we're going to be pulled into the ego, into some sort of work of modification, because we're not going to abide in it. But if we realize that this is a reminder of what we are, then we will abide in it. Because we know we need to be perfectly reminded. The reminder has to become perfect. We have to eventually give up any faint, even faint trace of believing we need to somehow change this effect. Or even improve upon it. Or do anything with it. Or that anything has to be done other than simply experience this effect. We have to get perfect at that. The only way to do that, of course, is simply to abide in it and get used to it. That's it. And since the quality of the isness never changes, we don't need to do anything to abide in it. We don't have to manipulate time at all. We don't have to manipulate circumstances at all. We don't have to do anything at all. Because the quality of the isness never changes, no matter what is done in existence. Simply need to abide in it, that's it. We don't need to meditate on it. The personality will say, oh, that's great, now I've got something to meditate on. Personality will say, great, now I've got a goal to aim for. Personality will say, great, now I got to figure out how to earn this as something permanent for me. So I got to go out and build 1,000 temples. Or make a pilgrimage. I need to figure out, how can I earn this permanently? But what Spirit knows is that Spirit already simply abides in, can abide in this without doing anything. Because the whole purpose of the overlay is so that Spirit abides in it and gets familiar with it. That's its only purpose, is familiarity. It's not a goal to be contemplated on set up on a wall, in a book, something to be experienced, directly experienced, immersed in, and familiarized with through experiencing it. Not familiarity through conceptualization or words. Not a goal to be reached. Not something of a personality to work towards, but something to be experienced directly right now. And continue to experience it directly right now, knowing that nothing in your life that will ever happen will change the quality of what you're experiencing right now one bit. Your death will not change it. Your sickness, your old age will not change it one bit. The aging of everyone else, the births of many people will not change it. Catastrophes will not change it. Therefore, there's no outcome that you need to work towards in existence other than abiding in the experience of the overlay. Whatever happens, the quality of the overlay is exactly the same. No distinctions. No differences. Don't have to work for, personality doesn't have to get to work for some outcome. Personality can just sit in the corner quietly, doesn't have to do anything, could be deactivated. Because again, we realize our only purpose is to get familiar with this experiencing, directly familiar. Not symbolize it and then get familiar with that symbol. Not put it in a book and then read about it every day. Which makes sense to the personality, but doesn't make any sense to the spirit. Because the concept is the overlay for personality. Personality will symbolize it and then believe that constantly focusing on that symbol is the overlay. Even if it's a guru, if it's like a picture of a guru and one's constantly paying attention to that picture, that's still at the level of the personality. Personality is believing that is experiencing the overlay and it's getting familiar with what the personality really is. That's not the way. Only direct experiencing of the overlay and abiding in that direct experiencing is the remembrance of what spirit really is. Again, the goal is not for personality to realize what it really is, because what really it really is simply a tool to distract us from choosing to remember what we are. So we already know what personality really is. Simply a tool of distraction. We don't need any more information on the personality. You see, that's it. The case is closed. Case on the personality is already closed. Close the case. Say, case dismissed. Personality, we know what you are. We don't need to abide in remembrance of who we are. We already have perfect clarity about what you are. What we need now, spirit needs to remember what it is. That's what needs to happen. So again, we don't need to symbolize it and then immerse ourselves in that symbol, which is, to tell you the truth, that's a lot of what happens in the world. There have been many who have caught a glimpse of the overlay for a minute, for a second, and then gone on to found all sorts of various, they symbolize it and then ritualize immersion in the symbol of it. That's the ego. That's the way of avoiding remembrance of what one really is. Again, we already know what personality is. We already know what ego is. We don't need any more evidence. The ego always say, you need more evidence because I'm always changing. I'm always getting greater and greater. No. Forgetfulness of what spirit is, it doesn't have any real meaning. You can't say that it's changing or growing or anything really, because it's always temporary. That's its nature. It's temporary and will and always subject, vulnerable to being replaced by choosing a new idea. Always. That is what it is. So when ego says we don't know what it is, that's a lie. We do know what ego is. Ego is futility, impossibility, temporary, impermanent, that which will be overlaid. That's what the ego is. That's what the personality is, that which will be overlaid. Right now, it's already overlaid. It's always been overlaid. The ego will ask you, well, when did the overlay start? Let's say you experience the overlay. The ego will say, that's great. Wow, when did this overlay start of the ego and the personality? I want to know, how did it come about? What led to it? What was the process? Okay, here's the answer to that. The ego has always been overlaid from the very beginning, simultaneous with spirit choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator. Simultaneous to that was the remedy, was the overlay, spirit choosing to not try and be prime creator. So the ego's always been overlaid from the very beginning. And the overlay was always just one effect. It hasn't changed at all. Zero process involved. Zero process. So the ego's questions of what kind of process led to it, there's no process that led to it. There was an idea that gave rise to this effect. I wonder if I should turn on the light right now. Let me see if I can do that. It's getting quite dark. Okay, there we go. Now we have the light. Just like that. The overlay. We choose the overlay, boom, you see. And we don't need to do anything with it. These are the reminders that spirit is interested in, that this video has presented, has shared. These are the reminders. And spirit knows when it's being reminded of truth, spirit knows it. But the personality, of course, will jump in and say, okay, that's great. Now let's do more. All the tricks of the personality will come up, all of them, as we have been spelling them out. Plenty of tricks. And the personality will always bring those up, use them, and say, on to the next thing. Great, on to the next thing. It's better. But the isness never gets better. It's already perfect. The present isness doesn't get better. So what can we get on to other than that? What other than the overlay should we be getting on to is the question. You might ask the personality, and this, and the personality says, well, you need to find out what I am. Remember what I am. And you say, I know what you are. You're a waste of time. You're futility. You're a distraction. You're an attempt to forget what I am. You're temporary. You're impermanent. You are overlaid. And that's it. Don't need to engage the personality anymore. You are that which is overlaid, already overlaid. Has always been overlaid. personality doesn't have much to say about that then, huh? Now, how did that all really happen? No, it just arose as an effect. See, the personality believes it's been developed through a process. It hasn't. Process is an illusion. We believe that everything is strung together, connected, but it's not. Everything that arises, in the moment, moment by moment by moment by moment by moment. But that's just a conceptual explanation. What we need to experience is the overlay, the isness, that it's very clear that the isness is not part of a process. It's one effect. It's not being affected by any other effect. It's totally stable. Perfect stability. Eternal, eternally. Overlays all time. Time doesn't affect it. It's an effect that is not being modified by time. Think about that. Consider that. If you want to contemplate, contemplate on an effect that is not being modified by time, can never be modified by time. That has never been modified in any way by time, has not been increased or decreased, has not been changed or modified or built up by time at all. It's not time dependent. In other words, time meaning process. No process touches it. No process will ever touch it. Contemplate that. And better yet, experience it. Contemplation is simply using the personality, until we can see that contemplation isn't it. That direct experiencing is it. Contemplation is still the personality. And sometimes a personality can get so deeply into contemplation that says, you know, don't disturb my contemplation. I'm in some deep contemplation. But it's better to consider the truth, as we are doing here, then it's better to do that than to sit in high contemplation, I'll tell you that. It's a higher, way higher path, because here we're very clearly pointing out the total limitation of that, and that it must be transcended into direct experiencing, abiding in the overlay, choosing a new idea. Contemplation is not that. So the personality can use contemplation as a defense against doing this. The personality will say it's doing something very high, very spiritual, and don't bother me. You know, I'm in this very high place. I'm taking higher and higher steps. I'm taking like that, and I'm going up this ladder, and I'm reaching, great spiritual experiences. I'm reaching. And don't stop this. Don't stop it. I cannot come out of this. Don't bother me. I don't want to be bothered. Don't tell me anything. I don't want to listen. Forget it. That's the personality. We'll say that. Personality is desperate to experience some high experience that will give an excuse to not choose a new idea. Desperate for that. They'll go anywhere. Pay any amount of money. See any teacher. And it's really saying, teacher, please give me something that is so good that I can just stay in that experience and not seek for any other, and I can avoid then choosing a new idea and experiencing the overlay. That's what they're really seeking for. The overlay is this silent, still presence of isness that is completely untouched by time. That is what it is. Only that reminds us of what spirit is. Only that experience. Anything else does not remind us of what we really are. And anything else is merely a distraction. Trying to compensate, trying to say, hey, I've got this, that's good enough. Why are you asking me to let go of this? How dare you? What an affront, you know. Jesus said, sell all your jewelry and buy the pearl of great price. That is what he was saying. He's saying, give up all these contemplations and spiritual experiences and powers and whatever other effects you're having. Set them all aside and experience the overlay. And only that is worth everything. The other stuff is worth nothing. The other stuff, as a matter of fact, is a distraction. It's a way of clinging to something that you think the clinging is justified. And in the clinging to that, refusing to experience the overlay. This personality will say, I have this high consciousness. I have this unity consciousness. I have something going on here. And I'm connecting with others, etc., etc. And this is a really advanced step. And I know I can see other steps beyond that. So how dare you interrupt this process of spiritualization that I'm undergoing? I feel I'm even going to meet my soulmate. And together we are going to be one, etc. How dare you interfere with that? You know, that's the personality, that's the ego, that's a trick of the ego. It's a way of the personality feeling righteous, self-righteous, and say, I can't give this up, I can't experience the overlay, because that would interfere with what I'm doing, with the beautiful experience that I'm having, the great spiritual trip that I'm on. How dare you ask me to interfere with that process? That process, I can tell me it's really leading somewhere, you know. No, it's not leading anywhere. Simply wasting time. Personality is simply a denial of what is. All we need to do is experience the isness. It's the only way. And abide in the isness, okay? It's more than experiencing it, it's abide in it. The personality will react to the experience of it, and then we follow the reactions of the personality. We're not abiding in the experience of the isness anymore. So the reactions of the personality to it are irrelevant. We already know what the personality is. Why do we need to follow its antics? It's that which has always been overlaid. By the overlay that we're presently experiencing, the very same overlay that has always overlaid the personality, we're experiencing that overlay right now. And we'll continue to experience it. And we will continue to experience the overlaying of the personality. Even though the personality may be thinking, hey, everybody, I'm being overlaid. It's the same overlay that's overlaying that, that has always overlaid that. So even though the personality might be, you know, running around telling everybody, man, I'm being overlaid by this presence, you know, wow. It's the very same presence that's always overlaid it. It's the very same presence always will overlay it, no change in it at all. So why pay attention to what the personality is saying or doing? That doesn't change anything. Simply abide in the overlay. You didn't see Ramana running around, knocking on doors, saying, folks, wow, you wouldn't believe that this is the experience I'm having. Something's overlaying me. I'm just as incredible. No, he just quietly, simply sat there, experiencing it. People would come to him and say, what should I do? And he said, sit quietly. Just sit here. This is what you do. You just experience it. And then personality would say, yeah, but what do you do next? He said, no. There is no next. Just experience it. Just abide in it. Just quiet. Just realize that it's perfect. It's not going to get any less. You don't need to go build a house for it. It's already at home. It's at home in itself. It's abiding in itself. Ananda, my mom would say that she's always home at home. She said, where can I go? I'm already at home. I'm merely myself, abiding in myself. Always. That's the overlay. The overlay always is simply abiding in itself. It's not seeking for anything. It's not seeking for some other condition. It's this untroubled stillness, quietness, peace beyond understanding. It's not trying to get anywhere or do anything. It's not seeking for a home. It's not seeking for an identity. It's not seeking to remember what it is. It already knows what it is. It is its own home. It's always been this way, always will be this way. It's not derived from any product, process, manufactured. It's not manufactured. It's not dependent on anything. It is an extension of the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That's not a dependency. It's an extension. It's a oneness. It's like the foundation extends itself. Foundation rests on the foundation, rests within the foundationness. The isness rests within the isness. The isness is. It's not trying to be the isness. It is the isness. It's not trying to prevent itself from becoming less. There's no modifications. You don't need to check in with it tomorrow. Because tomorrow it'll be exactly the same as it is right now. So from the standpoint of isness, there is no tomorrow. There is no change. There is no time. It's not asking anyone to wait. Wait till tomorrow. I'll be better tomorrow. It's not like we have the experience of isness and the isness says, you think this is great? Come back tomorrow. Wow, that'll really be great. The isness doesn't say anything. It just is perfectly reposed within itself. And somehow the isness is giving me these words to speak. Not that I am reposing in it at this time. Be a different situation. When that is the case, it'll be a different situation for sure. Much more profound, but somehow I'm able to share the voice of the isness, so to speak, be a mouthpiece for it, but not an experiencing of it. But this is helpful, very, very, very helpful. Helpful to remind spirit that it can focus on what is really important to spirit and can be reminded of this. And spirit will say, yes, that's right, okay. I see the tricks that the personality's been playing on me. I experience the overlay, and then the personality says, wow, congratulations. Come back tomorrow and it'll be even better. Or congratulations, now you need to plant flowers all around the overlay, you know, beautify it. The overlay is beyond beauty. Something more profound. It's that which overlays beauty. There's nothing that is more beautiful to spirit than non-modification, experiencing the overlay, non-modification, an effect that is not changing, it's at all, no changing, because that's a reminder of reality. And all beauty is within reality. So as far as our position is concerned, there's nothing more beautiful than the overlay. The overlay cannot be beautified. It's 100% beautiful. It's the essence. In the position that we're in, it's the essence of beauty. The very essence of it. So how could it be made more? It cannot. anything, flowers that are planted around it, are only served to attract towards it, but are to be transcended in the direct experiencing of it. But the personality, of course, doesn't see it that way. The personality says, if we put flowers all around it, it's going to be even more beautiful. And then what happens when we experience it again? The personality will say, it wasn't that great. Now we can even make it more. But then we might say, no, wait a minute. No, it was the same as before. Same overlay. It was perfect, just as before. So we don't really need to go planting flowers all around it. A minimal amount, maybe, of beautification, perhaps that's okay. So that there's some feeling, symbols of it. A little bit of symbolization is a slight concession to the situation that everybody's in, perhaps. We'll see. I think teachers have traditionally allowed a little bit of that. So others can say, have some sort of familiar framework. The personality can have some familiar framework. But then the spirit goes to work on what really matters. What really matters is, which is what we have accomplished, attempted to accomplish here. And I believe we have accomplished quite a bit here. That's my feeling. Very strong feeling that we've touched on a very deep area. Touched upon it and spent some time in it. You may wonder why we're spending 2 hours on this, because again, the goal is to abide in the experience of the overlay continuously, 24 hours a day. Whether you're awake or asleep, the abidance is in the overlay. And the purpose is to, so we need to touch upon this fact, this important key fact, and we need to touch upon the very deepest level of what is pulling us out of that abidance. And we need to try and touch upon it in a sustained way. Not as a substitute, but as a reminder of what it is that we're really aiming towards. Don't run off. Don't just have a brief glimpse and then run off. Okay, that's why satsang is important, that it has some sustainability to it. You get an insight, you just don't run off. Say, okay, I need to go out and plant some flowers, you know. I need to go out and sweep the walk. I need to run out in the street and tell everybody, come on in, this is great. No, stay with it. Keep touching the insight. Keep touching upon it. Keep deepening it. Keep looking. And then that's when things start to widen out. And you start to touch upon deeper areas. And you start to see the real tricks that the ego uses. And how those tricks have cost us so much delay. And it will continue to cost us endless delay if we don't see through those tricks. Because again, the ego's tricks are always, tomorrow will be better. Better time. Be more. Come back again tomorrow. The ego will say, yeah, that was a great experience you had. Divine experience, wonderful. Now come back tomorrow, it'll be even better. Something to that effect. But that is not the purpose of the experience. The purpose of the experience is saying, the invitation is, abide in this. Don't run off. Don't make other plans. You don't have to run off from this at all. Because it will never change. So what is he running off for really accomplishing? What you're experiencing right now as the overlay will always be exactly the same quality. So why run off? To what end? To what purpose? Except to avoid abiding in it, which means to avoid having perfect remembrance of what one is. It's avoidance. So in satsang, we have long time frames, so we don't get into avoidance. It's not a 5-minute thing. It's not a boom, yeah, okay, I got it. Now what? We get used to sticking with it, staying with it, Even though this talk is not the direct experiencing of it, there is still a process of familiarity. The notion of sticking with it is building. It's building. People that came to see Ramana, they just sat there all day. Some of them all day, all night. Maybe they eat a little bit, and they go back and sit there silently, quietly. Maybe some of them for years. Just quietly feeling what Ramana was all about, what she was abiding in this overlay, abiding in the self. And getting that that was all that is necessary, didn't need to come back tomorrow. If they left and went away for a couple of years and came back, they would find out that Ramana is in the exact same condition as before. No change. His condition hadn't deepened, gotten more profound. It was the pristine purity was exactly the same. And so they would say, wow, why did I leave? What did I gain? You know, well, because the personality ego told them they would gain something somehow. So we're bringing to light the tricks of the ego. Not that the tricks will stop. Won't stop them. The only remedy is to abide in the overlay. That's the only remedy. Because the ego won't stop at tricks. Even if we abide in the overlay for 20 years, the ego will still be saying, come out of it in another year. If you come out of it now, then another year, it'll be way, way better because you'll be able to work on stuff. You'll be able to, like, expand it in the world and all this stuff. So come out of it so that the ego will continue to offer up its tricks, saying, come out of it, come out of it. But the more one stays in it, the less one is tempted to come out of it. But the ego will continually, you know, suggest those things. The world will continue to suggest it. It's just that one eventually has zero interest in that and doesn't even hear it. But the ego won't stop. Doesn't stop. You can't stop the ego from doing what it does because it's an effect of an idea. Effects of an idea cannot be stopped from being what they are. So one can never change the ego. One can simply pay no attention to its temptations. That's it. And so in hearing this, we get closer to actually doing it, to giving up trying to, you know, change the ego. The ego will tell us, you know, if you just come out of the overlay, you'll have the power to change me and I won't bother you anymore. Ah, that's maybe its number one trick, isn't it? We're in the overlay, we're experiencing it, and it's this perfect isness. And the ego says, wow, that's fantastic, but I want you to come out of it. And you say, no, ego, that's a trick. And the ego say, ah, you got me. Okay, I'll tell you what, though. You've got so much spiritual power now, capacity, and you're so great that you, if you come out of this right now, you will be able to silence me forever. I'll never come back and tempt you again because I know you can do it. You got the capacity now. And then we might think, ah, okay, I don't like being barred by this ego. I'd really like to be in this perfect isness all the time without any temptation at all. And so the ego's telling me if I come out of it, I now have the spiritual power to crush the ego and get rid of it forever. It'll never tempt me again. So what do? We drop the overlay, and then we're vulnerable to all the other tricks of the ego suddenly. And of course, we don't crush the ego at all. We simply begin to pay more and more attention to it, because then we say, okay, now how am I doing? You know, ego, what's going on with you now? Are you tempting me less, you know? And the ego will say, oh yeah, I'm tempting you less. Just keep doing it. I'm tempting you less. I'm almost there. And it'll string you along. And all this time you're not experiencing the overlay. That's how it happens. So when the ego tells you, come out, you can now crush me. I will submit to you. Say, no. That's a trick, ego. I'll stay here. You keep tempting me. I'll keep rejecting the temptation. because eventually I won't even pay any attention to you. But I know that it's impossible to stop you from at least trying to tempt me. It's impossible, because you're an effect of an idea. And you will always function that way. So it's futility to do that. And in fact, it actually causes forgetfulness of what I am if I try to do that. Because then I'll believe that all other effects of ideas I choose can also be modified, which is the worst thing possible to believe that. So don't try and change the ego. Simply accept the overlay of the ego and realize that the temptation of the ego will become less and less and less. You'll be less interested in it as one abides in the overlay. And that's it. We got to the great trick of the ego, its last resort. Come out of the overlay, and I will submit, and I'll give up any more temptation, and then you can go back, and you won't be bothered. That's the final trick of the ego. It doesn't have any more after that. If we reject that trick, it doesn't have any more, really. It can say, come out of the overlay, and I will stop tempting someone else. So that's a corollary to the trick. If that one fails, it'll say, okay. But the ego will say, I'm pestering everybody else and they're not accepting the overlay. But if you come out of the overlay as a sacrifice, I will stop pestering everybody else. Again, another lie. The ego cannot stop pestering anyone. It's impossible. Ego will say, be the great sacrifice. Come out of the overlay. Experience all the misery and suffering of existence. And if you do that, I will then stop bothering anybody else. I'll just bother you. I won't bother anybody else. That's a lie. The ego will always tempt everything in existence, continuously. But as we abide in the overlay, we become immune to that temptation. That's the only way. The ego cannot stop tempting. So the notion that anyone has been sacrificed in order to enable all the rest of us to be free of the ego's temptation is a lie of the ego. It's impossible that take place. That would be a modification of an effect of an idea, which is impossible. Modification of purpose, it's impossible. The ego's purpose is to tempt us towards forgetfulness of what we are. It will always do that. And as we abide in the overlay, the ego is continuously tempting everybody else. That is true. We can't stop that. But we can show everybody else the way to get free of this temptation. And it's not to crush the ego, not to change the ego, not to give up our abidance in the overlay so as to appease the ego's quote-unquote wrath towards others so it will then stop pestering others. That's delusion. That's the ego. It's a trick of the ego. Many have been tricked in this way. Sacrifice doesn't work. Guaranteed it doesn't work. Giving up your experience in the overlay profits no one. Profits no one. Except the ego. And the ego has no profit to give anyone. Only delay. It only strengthens the ego's delay to do that. So abide in the experience of the overlay and stay in that experience. That's the only remedy. And we're grateful for those who did that. Recent ones, Ramana Maharshi and Anandamaya Ma, are two examples of it. Ones who all they did was simply abide in that overlay. That is it. That's all they asked of us, nothing more. And they never left the overlay for a minute. Anandamaya Ma testified that she never for even one moment ever left the experiencing of the overlay. Never. See, that's correct witnessing for us. In other words, there was no sacrificing of her experiencing of truth, of what spirit is. As if that were going to have some positive effect, as if a deal could be made with the ego. You cannot make any deal with the ego. It's impossible. And I better stop this video before anything weird happens with YouTube. We've got it so far in the can, right? 2:14. Fantastic video. I'm going to stop it right now so this can be shared with you. Very great. That's it.